You are listening to the Be a Better Being podcast, hosted by the founder of Better Beings, Michelle Zellner. Michelle's experiences have equipped her with knowledge and perspective, and for nearly three decades, she has been informing, influencing, and inspiring thousands on their journeys. This show spotlights guests of diverse backgrounds and areas of expertise, but they all align with Michelle's purpose and passion to help you be a better human being. There is something for everyone on their way to a healthier, happier life. Enjoy the show.
Greetings. Thank you for tuning into the Be a Better Being podcast. I'm Michelle Zellner, your host. We are wrapping up Healthy Aging Month, and I think I would be remiss if I didn't include a conversation on a super sexy topic, something that if you are a female and you live long enough, you are going to experience, which also means if you are not a female and you live long enough, you're going to be around a whole bunch of females who are experiencing it. So I think it's important to have this conversation, and I'm super excited to invite Peach Grayson on to help us navigate this fun conversation on menopause. Peach, thanks for joining.
Thank you very much for having me. I appreciate the time and opportunity.
Well, it is my pleasure. This is something that I actually find fascinating right now because people are very openly talking about it. I actually do a lot of corporate wellness on this topic for like specific employee working groups, resource groups. I don't know, maybe it's just because Gen Xers are now in that phase of life. Maybe that's why it's a big conversation. I'll tell the listeners a little bit about my experience, but first I want to hear from you. So let's share who you are, why you're talking about this, and what we're going to do to really probably hopefully change the conversation about it.
So like you said, I'm Peach Grayson. I ended up writing a series of three books on menopause, and my whole goal was when I started going through perimenopause, I started looking for information, looking for answers, and all I really found were medical journals and books that were 600 pages long, and nothing that I really felt hit home with me. And so after research and a few years of meeting with my doctors and talking with friends and just having these conversations with a lot of other people, I decided, well, there isn't a book out there that I like. I'm just going to write it myself. So I did.
And I love that.
You know, I was looking for information that gave me bits and pieces about menopause, signs and symptoms, treatment options, but wasn't all medical jargon. I've spent my life in the healthcare industry, so it wasn't as though I couldn't understand it. It just wasn't presented the way that I wanted it. And so the books that I ended up writing have a lot of humor. They have a lot of sarcasm, which is very much my personality. And so I was just hoping that I could reach other women out there that might be looking for that same information in a format that's just a little more easier to digest, kind of like having a conversation with a girlfriend.
I love that. And you actually have written a series of three books. So tell us a little bit about the different approach for each of the books, because I think this is genius and so necessary.
So the first book is Let's Talk Menopause, You're Not Crazy. And this one is chocked full of humor and sarcasm. Like I said, very much like me. It's designed as a journal entry, and the main character looks back on her journal entries as her wiser self, understanding then, you know, what was happening. Because sometimes I think in the midst of perimenopause, we don't even realize what's going on. We're angry, we're frustrated, we're hot. You know, there's all these things that are happening, but sometimes it just takes years for us to look back and go, oh, I bet I was in menopause this whole time. And so that sets up the first book. The second book is called Let's Talk Menopause, Fact Versus Fiction. And this is really more straight talk, really geared towards the reader that maybe doesn't appreciate my sarcasm, but giving them all of the information in bite-sized pieces, something that they can take away with. You know, there's key takeaways in the book, and I think it helps people realize what options are available. You know, it goes through drug options, but it also goes through homeopathic options and even lifestyle changes. Because sometimes, you know, our biggest resource is just things that we can do in our life to make changes, to make this process or phase of life a little easier. And the final book is Let's Talk A Man's Guide to Understanding Her BSC Level. So this is really geared towards men, and it is very much sarcastic.
Okay, yes. Quick. Let's just clarify BSC level. Those who maybe not have like connected the dot, I already know what it is, but what is that?
So BSC level is a batshit crazy level. Yeah. And as a woman, I think we all know there's a little bit of batshit crazy in all of us. And the book is really geared towards men and helping men understand women and what we're going through during the menopause phase, but even just during our hormonal phase of life, because unfortunately hormones kind of dictate, you know, our lives from very early on. Now it's like from age 12 onward. And so that book is really geared towards helping men understand what's happening to a woman and hopefully giving them some better tips and tricks on how to handle situations. So instead of a man coming, you know, and trying to fix it, which is always their first idea, you know, it just gives them ways to communicate with their partners or loved ones, better understanding of what's happening to them and how to help them without trying to fix it. Because, you know, menopause is one of those things, you can't fix it. It's just part of life, and we just have to find our best way to get through it.
Yeah. So I want to even start very basic level, because not only do men not understand this, women don't understand this. And I know this because I've been teaching about menopause for at least 10 years. So I am, at the time of this recording, I'm 51. I actually went through menopause roughly around age 39. I say roughly because I'm actually not quite sure exactly when, because I have a kind of very unique experience. It was not medically induced. It was not because of any kind of cancer or anything like that. It was a natural early menopause. So I want to start with even the definitions. People don't even know what it means. And so perimenopause, right? I think this is part of our confusion, because we actually don't know the definitions because we're never taught. We are not taught these things. So perimenopause is going through menopause. That is what that phase is called. It's called perimenopause. Premenopause is your entire life up until you hit perimenopause.
Yeah.
And perimenopause can start in your young 30s. So yes. I really think this conversation needs to be had with people, women and men, in their early to mid 30s. And so many people think, oh, I'm too young for that, which is, it's, and oh my gosh, let me tell you, the number of doctors that I had to educate along the way is, it's really disturbing, quite honestly. You know, you go to a checkup and they always ask, when was your last cycle? And I'll say, oh, you know, I went through menopause at 39. You know, the first question I get is, are you sure?
I believe it.
And that's either followed up or preceded by, oh, you're too young. You're too young. Are you sure? Okay. A body is a body. Okay. And every body is different. And so, yes, I'm sure. So perimenopause is the phase of life when the hormone production starts changing. Right. And that's what it is. And how do those changes look? Well, for some people, it is a very dramatic plunge of progesterone, followed by an erratic and gradual decrease in estrogen. For some people, it is a gradual fluctuation and erratic behavior of both of them. For some people, perimenopause lasts 6 months. For some people, it lasts 15 years.
Right.
And so this is why I think it's so important for people to understand the individual differences. Whenever somebody comes to me in their early 40s and they start, you know, talking about they're frustrated with this or this, or they have this or this, and I will always say, my guess is you are going through menopause. Oh, no, I still have a very regular cycle. Okay, that's fine. You are probably still going through menopause. That is perimenopause. So as somebody with healthcare background, am I right? Do I have this correct? Like, share.
You are 100% correct.
Okay, because I don't have a healthcare background. I have a human experience background, and I understand a little bit about the human body. And this is just kind of what I've learned to understand based on experience and, you know, that limited knowledge that I have. So why are doctors not educating us about this?
And I'm not sure that's a question I can answer. I don't know. I honestly don't know. I do think that it's something that a lot of physicians just glaze over. They see it as a part of life. And I wish I had a better answer. I honestly don't know. It's frustrating. And so many women encounter physicians that don't take them seriously, have no interest in helping them, treating them, or just like you, they'll say, oh, it's too early. And the whole idea of perimenopause is difficult because there's no one test. It's not like you can go in and have a blood test and a doctor can say, oh, today you're perimenopause and this is a normal, you know, treatment options, A, B, and C. It just isn't like that because you can have your hormones tested at 8 o'clock in the morning and it looked like you're not in perimenopause at all. And you can have your hormones tested the same day at 3 p.m. and all of a sudden you've got a drastic decrease in hormones. So testing your blood and your hormones, they're just not really very beneficial because it's only telling you what's happening at that exact moment. And like you said, hormones go up, they go down, and they can just really be crazy during this time. And I wish that I could say I understood why physicians weren't better at educating their patients, at treating their patients, at giving them options. Some are really good, but unfortunately, it seems like the majority of them just don't.
Well, and my guess is because they're uneducated, right? Yeah. They don't spend a lot of time in their training. And I know this because I follow several of them on Instagram, female doctors who are Gen Xers who are going through menopause and all of a sudden start to realize, wait a second, I know medicine, I know human behavior, I know me, I know something's different, and I know I'm going through menopause. Maybe we should start looking at this. Yeah. So, you know, and they share that most of them, and I follow some OBGYNs, they get most of the hours of their training helping people get pregnant and have babies.
Yeah.
They spend almost no time in their training learning about menopause, which is interesting since, again, every single female, if you live long enough, every single one will go through menopause. Not every female wants to or is going to have babies.
Right.
So it is kind of interesting how the practice is very much geared kind of, you know, following cultural and societal norms, very much geared to the young. And yeah, once you're old, yeah.
Yep.
Just go be old. Just go figure it out. Right?
You're on your own.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, hormones rule your life. That is, I've been saying that. I teach a class. It's called Hormones Rule. Because they do. And this isn't just females. This is every human. We're all made up of lots and lots and lots of different hormones. And hormones control every single thing that goes on, physically, mentally, and emotionally. So I do think it is important to get lab work done. You might not be able to get an exact idea of exactly where you are, but you look at that lab work in combination with your experiences, and we can start to make some pretty good decisions or pretty good, you know, suppositions based on that. And so I'm a fan of people getting some baseline. And I think especially if you still have a regular cycle, you can time it to where you should be in your cycle and kind of get a better sense of what those numbers, the ranges kind of look like in various, you know, phases of the pre, peri, and postmenopausal experience. But for so many, it's simply dismissed as, oh, that won't tell you anything, so why bother? And then, you know, as a woman, you listen to your doctor, you're like, oh, well, I just must be crazy. Or, oh, well, I'm just depressed. Put me on an antidepressant. Or, oh, well, I just keep gaining weight, so I guess I have to try harder. Or, oh, well, my blood pressure has all of a sudden gone up for seemingly no reason. It must be because of X, Y, and Z.
Yeah.
Or my memory isn't where it used to be. Or my motivation and my energy aren't where they used to be. yes, every one of those things could be related to a perimenopausal experience.
Yeah, no, you're 100% right.
And unfortunately, in the world we live in, it is, prescribe a pharmaceutical. Just take a pill for this, for that, for all of these symptoms.
Right.
These are all experiences as your hormones change. So it's interesting, too, that we call them symptoms of menopause, as if menopause is a disease. I mean, I think the verbiage around this whole topic is quite fascinating. And it just kind of lends itself into this, like, you know, kind of icky, yucky subject that we don't want to talk about. You have menopause. Anyway, that's my soapbox. So share a little bit, if you will, about, I mean, you wrote a book about it, so I'm guessing you've had an experience you're willing to share. So I want to hear yours, and then I want to share mine. And my guess is they are completely opposite ends of the spectrum.
So my individual experience is definitely different than yours. I actually had a hysterectomy when I was 29, but they left my ovaries. So then I would go through menopause naturally. It's not uncommon for women that have had hysterectomies where they have left the ovaries to go into menopause earlier. Honestly, I don't think that I actually went into a postmenopausal phase where I was truly done until about 53. So my biggest problem was, I didn't have any ability to see changes in my cycle. I just didn't have that. So I spent years going through a divorce and a new marriage and bits of rage and confusion and frustration and anger and a lot of emotional roller coasters. And then once I finally, what I think put me into a postmenopausal phase, kind of looked back and went, holy crap, I was probably in menopause that whole time. And everything that I went through, I probably could have had some kind of help. But of course, for me, it was just, I chalked it up to, you know, a bad marriage, a this, a that, you know, overworked it, or overstressed with work, every other reason under the sun. And I think, honestly, it took me 10 years to really look back and realize what had happened, because I was under the same illusion as most people. You know, when I hit my 50s, I thought, well, I'm young and I still have my ovaries and, you know, I don't have any of the, didn't have hot flashes and I didn't have night sweats until about a year ago. So I didn't really even think that I had started menopause or had gone through anything until about a year ago. And I finally gone to the doctor and had some of my hormone levels checked. And of course, you know, my FSH was sky high. And I thought, huh, so I'm actually postmenopausal at this point, and I didn't even know it. So I feel like I suffered way more than I had to. And like I said, I started looking for information out there, and I just didn't find what I was looking for. But it was hard because not having a cycle every month, I didn't really have anything to judge. So I couldn't tell when it was becoming irregular. And since I didn't have your typical night sweats and hot flashes, it just didn't dawn on me until it was too late. And I think for me, my menopausal journey was very emotional. I had lost a best friend during the course of that to pancreatic cancer. And so again, I chalked up a lot of my ability to cry while I'm sitting on a beach, because I had plenty of those days while I'm on vacation and I'm sitting on a beach and all of a sudden I'm just crying. And of course I think, well, it was due to the loss of my friend and it was due to this, and just, I blamed everything else without ever realizing. So it was a difficult journey because I didn't have the typical symptoms and I didn't have a uterus to help me even see where there were changes coming from. So I feel like my journey was very unique, but probably there's plenty of other women just like me that don't have the typical hot flashes or didn't. And so I think to me, that's the first sign that people think of. And if you don't have that, then all of the other symptoms we want to blame on everything else. I had lots of opportunities where I swear I didn't think my brain worked. I couldn't remember things. I couldn't come up with common words. I had an instance where I was trying to give directions and I said to my husband, you're going to exit and go left across, you know, you're going to go left. And he's looking at me like, are you having a stroke? And I'm like, you know, you take that over road. And he said, the bridge? I was like, yes. I just couldn't think of the word. It was such a common word. And boy, some of those things, they get under your skin. And then you feel, you're like, I'm glad I was with my husband and I'm not giving, you know, some kind of presentation at work because I would feel like a complete idiot when you can't come up with very simple words. But my brain was not going to think of that. And of course, today we joke about it. And, you know, every now and then he'll go, oh, get on that over road over there. And it's like, you know, I can laugh about it now, but at the moment it was frustrating because I couldn't figure out why my brain didn't work. Yeah. It was a wretched experience. And it's like, I feel empathy for every woman, you know, during their menopausal journey. Cause it's very few women have I ever heard go, oh yeah, menopause was nothing.
So let's get to my story. Menopause was nothing, truly.
Wow.
But before we get to my story, I want to highlight a few things. Number one, it was a wretched experience and it didn't have to be, right?
No.
My guess is, had you known this is a common situation when you go through menopause, you would have maybe given yourself some grace, maybe not had started to doubt yourself about your competence and your ability to communicate. And maybe that would have led to different experiences and outcomes.
Oh, yes.
And that's why I think these conversations are so important for women to understand that these things don't just happen for no reason, right? Like, I don't just start not being able to formulate a sentence for no reason. Your heightened emotions. My guess is you would probably have still cried. Even if you weren't going through menopause, you would still have those days of tremendous grief and sadness of losing your friend that would lead to you crying. But you add menopause on top of that. And it's like, I can't not do this. And it's happening frequently at times when it doesn't feel like it should be happening, right? And then again, we're like, oh, you're so sensitive. You're too emotional. Well, when someone that you maybe spend time with keeps on telling you that you're too emotional and you're too sensitive, how does that start to make you feel? How does that relationship start to evolve? Does that lead to changes in the nature of communication with your partner? Of course, the answer is yes, right? And so when we think about all the ways that hormones rule our lives, they literally rule everything. So yes, if you are seeing changes, you know what is normal for you, and then you're seeing things that are kind of out of the norm. And yeah, we throw into the mix, these are the times of life when we're stressed because we're taking care of kids, we're taking care of aging parents, we're working ourselves, we're not getting sleep, we're not eating right, we're not exercising because we're taking care of kids, we're taking care of aging parents, we're taking care of, you know, job opportunities, right? And so it's all of these things that kind of come together at this exact moment in time. And that is sometimes why it's really difficult to either acknowledge or even to have the awareness that the menopause experience, going through menopause, is definitely impacting every other one of these experiences.
Yeah.
It's not the reason for all the experiences, but it's contributing to what that is. So mine, like I said, went, I think, menopause. And here's why I think, and same with you, it's hard to know. The traditional marking of being through menopause, post-menopausal, right? Through menopause and post-menopause are kind of phrases we use interchangeably. Perimenopause and going through menopause are the phrases we use interchangeably. So post-menopausal is generally marked by one full year with no menstrual cycle. Well, for someone like you who doesn't have a uterus and is not having a cycle, well, then how do I know, right?
Yep.
For somebody like me who was very irregular, very sporadic, very erratic, you lose track of when you do and don't, and then I'm like, oh, so here's how I kind of sort of figured it out. Because I'm very irregular and sporadic and erratic, I kind of always have to be prepared because I never know. And usually this is going to be really important if I'm traveling. So there happened to be like a lot of traveling going on in this chunk of time. And I kept thinking, oh, I'm probably going to get it on this trip. And then I wouldn't. And then it's like, oh, it's probably going to come on this trip. And then I did it. And oh, it's right. And I kept doing this for, and all of a sudden it was a year. And I'm like, wait a minute. I thought I was going to have it on that trip. And that trip was over a year ago. Oh, so now going back 6 months, those three nights that I woke up with the bed soaking wet, oh, those were night sweats. Oh, okay. And that was it.
Wow.
That is the, and it was only because I went backwards and I was like, oh. So, yes, I know. I was like, oh my gosh, you, I hate you because you had like nothing, right?
However, no, actually, I think you're an inspiration because at least you give us hope that maybe not everybody's journey has to be as difficult, even if they're aware, you know, of it. It just means that literally it could be from a scale of 1 to 100. You could be 1, you could be 100, and it still be your particular journey. But yeah, no, I think you're an inspiration. It's like, oh,
well, that would be so wonderful. I'd like to take credit for it, but I really had nothing to do with it. My body is my body. I have since also realized that I was just my whole life a very low hormone producing human. So I think the menopause experience for many people is the combination of three things. One, your relative amount of production of estrogen and progesterone. Two, the proportion and ratio of each of those to each other. And three, the lifestyle habits that you engage in.
Yeah.
It's the combination of all of those things. So me being a very low hormone producing human meant that even if there was dramatic fluctuation in them, I had so little of both that the fluctuations and the disproportionality, right, that state of estrogen dominance, which is what causes all the problems, or all the experiences, I should say. Mine was such an insignificant degree of dominance because I had very little of both. And so my experience is going to be very, very minimal. Now, somebody who has a high amount of both and then they go to almost no progesterone and still a whole bunch of estrogen, yeah, that's going to be very different.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the, you know, nutrition, exercise, stress, all of those things, which by my late 30s, I had pretty well buttoned all of those up. Prior to my early 30s, it was a complete disaster shit show of all of that. That's all part of the story. But by that time, you know, mid to late 30s, everything was pretty dialed in. And then going forward, it's been even more dialed in. And then knowing how important hormones are. Because for someone like me, who's been without hormones for decades longer than most women, that's not great. Because these hormones protect your bones, protect your brain,
yeah,
protect your mood, protect your heart, reduce your risk for cancer. Yes. Yes, women, reduce your risk for cancers. That's true. Yeah, does not cause cancer. We'll talk about that in a moment. Well, that made me realize, wow, this is not good to be without hormones for this long in my life. And that's when I decided to start exploring hormone replacement therapy, which we can probably talk about as well. So let's go back to some of these things here. Another thing that I think is a problem in the verbiage and the messaging, and you've probably heard this, right? The average onset of menopause is 51.
Right.
Peach, are you an average person?
Nope.
Great. Neither am I. So anytime I hear the average this of anything, I'm like, who cares? It doesn't matter. All that does, you know what that does? That sets an expectation. That tells women, well, unless I'm 51, this isn't happening.
Right.
Which is why we miss a whole bunch of stuff. So as you did that reflection on your menopause journey, what are some of the things that had you maybe known it could go do it all over, What are some of the things that you would do differently?
I think if I had realized over the course of, say, the 10 years that I feel like I was really going through the perimenopausal phase, I would have sought out some treatment options, something that I didn't ever do. I didn't ever really have a conversation with my physician because for me, everything was very emotional. And I think in society, it's a stigma. And I wasn't interested in someone telling me, well, you're just depressed or you have anxiety or some other label. And I wasn't, you know, interested in just mood altering drugs. So I never really did seek out the professional assistance I could have had. And I think now looking back, I really was one of those people that would have benefited from an antidepressant. And I know this is terrible to say, but had I realized that my emotional state was most likely due to menopause, mentally, I would have been more agreeable to an antidepressant because it would be menopause that had caused me to feel like I did versus my own insecurity that I was just depressed or that I just had a bad marriage or just wasn't a happy person or whatever, you know, I created in my own head. If I had realized it was menopause, I think I would have just been more willing to get treatment, which would have just made everything probably 10 times better. I think I also would have made lifestyle changes. I know now and realize now sugar is a really big trigger for me. So once I cut sugar out of my diet, a lot of my menopausal symptoms really drastically reduced. And I never made that link because I didn't make the link of it being perimenopause. And if I had been aware at that point that one, I was in perimenopause and two, having a conversation with lifestyle changes and my diet, I probably could have reduced my symptoms drastically years earlier.
And I want to throw into not just sugar, but alcohol.
Well, I don't drink, so it's a good one for me. I never realized it, but yeah.
Right. And I know because I've been talking to so many women lately and they realize, wow, alcohol is really not helpful through menopause. I mean, it's not really helpful ever because it is a poison. And I am not judging anyone who chooses to have a beverage. I had my first beverage of the year a few weeks ago. Wonderful and delightful. But it's just not something I engage in regularly because I can take it or leave it and I'd rather leave it. However, when your body is in flux, anything that is not helpful when it's not in flux is going to make most things a lot worse when it is in flux, right?
Yeah.
Because these hormones, the optimal levels and balance of our hormones is what keeps us young and thriving and happy and energetic and allows us to get away with a lot of really poor choices and seemingly not have a negative impact on us. Well, when we no longer have the benefit of optimal and balanced hormones, these choices that actually are not great for a human, they no longer have the protection. And so the outward expression of all of that stuff is going to really start to show itself. And as most people know, the longer you go doing something, the harder it is to make a habit change. And so now here you are, you've been, you know, doing life however you feel like it, and it's great. And now you're 50 and all the things you used to do and be able to do, you can't seem to do anymore. And you think, oh, it's because I'm not trying hard enough. No, it's probably because you don't have the balance and the optimal hormones anymore to help you get away with it. I mean, that's probably what it is, right?
Yeah.
So what is your take on hormone replacement?
I think that I know there's a lot of controversy around it. And I think that you can find studies that support the benefits of HRT. You can find studies that, you know, claim that it causes cancer, increases the risk of cancer. And I think a lot of that is how the studies are run and how the data is interpreted. So I have a hard time with people claiming, well, this particular study says that it causes cancer and this particular study says it's 100% safe. I think the science behind the loss of our hormones and the benefit of them support HRT or a hormone replacement therapy, because it seems as though most women benefit from it. And I know there are some women that can't, that it's contraindicated, and I get that. And it isn't something that I have looked into at this point, because like I said, I only realized in like the last 2 years that, yeah, I'm actually postmenopausal, and who knew? But I think it's an individual choice. I think that women really have to decide for themselves if it's something that is what is good for them. And unfortunately, I don't have a lot of confidence in those conversations with physicians, because physicians seem to be 100% one way or the other. And if you're a woman who believes that HRT is going to be right for you and your physician doesn't prescribe it, they don't believe in it, then you're just kind of screwed. And, you know, we're at a later part of our life. Sometimes we've had, you know, relationships with our physicians for 20, 30 years. And it's hard to say to a woman, if your physician refuses HRT without a valid reason outside of they just don't believe it, they believe that, you know, it's going to cause you to have cancer, then you need to find another physician. You need to go and look for a second opinion. And I know some women personally decide it's not for them, and you have to make that individual decision. But I also think that having those conversations with physicians is hard, because they just seem to be really one-sided one way or the other. I haven't run into many physicians that, you know, are agreeable to HRT and then push other women not to do it. I don't know. Just seems like they're all one way or the other.
Yeah. As somebody who's been studying this for 7 or 8 years now, I'm hopeful that with now the WHO, the WHO, finally, 20 years after the study was published, finally coming out and admitting that their study was entirely wrong. Yeah. And I'm hoping that's actually going to change the conversation and the perception with physicians. It's going to be a slow ship to turn around. But all of the fear that was instilled in people is because of this one study, not probably more than 20 years ago now, that showed a very slight increased risk in breast cancer in a very small population of the study group. And once that showed it, they said, nope, this is dangerous. Everybody stop your hormones. And now they have finally circled back and said, you know, that was this message we've been pushing that hormones cause cancer. It's not true. It's not accurate. There are a small subset of people for whom hormone therapy, however, it's also specifically how it's administered and in ratio with progesterone and possibly testosterone,
right,
that also is going to matter whether this actually increases your risk for cancer, for clotting, for all the reasons that I've had friends tell me, oh, I can't do hormones because I have this issue. I think it's worth a second look. You know, when you realize that we were dead way, 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 way before we even started using our hormones, right? Like, women didn't make it past childbirth.
Right.
Well, now we're not dead. We're here. And so I really think for a lot of people, it's deciding on quality of life and risk of other disease protection. Because postmenopause, your risk for every disease goes up. Brain health disorders, heart disease, diabetes, it all goes up, because these hormones are what keep you balanced and able to make choices that help you thrive and all the things. And so when people are deciding whether this is a good choice for them or not, it really is about deciding quality of life and, you know, lifestyle choices, because hormones are not the magic answer either.
All right.
You still have to engage in different lifestyle habits. And I think that's also part of the frustration for a lot of women that I talk to is, you know, they feel like they're doing all the right things and they're not seeing results that they think they should see. And my answer is very often, at least in part, it's because you don't have optimal and balanced hormones, because that's the phase of life you're in.
Yeah.
So you can make all the right choices, but if you don't have the chemistry to back up those right choices, you're not going to get the outcome that you want. You can have the best chemistry in the world, optimal and balanced hormones. If you're not making the choices to support your amazing chemistry, you're also not going to get the ultimate result. Yeah. It's always the combination of all of those things. And so it does come down to that personal decision. I absolutely 1000% am on board, and I will do them forever and ever and ever. When people think, oh, it's going to increase your risk for things, just to have some critical thinking. If we were born with these hormones, and these are the hormones that when we're young, they are at optimal and balanced levels, why didn't they kill us then? I mean, if these hormones are so dangerous, why aren't we dead when we're 20, when they're at their optimal levels? That doesn't make any sense. And so I think it's something that each human, each individual would benefit by being a very critical thinker on it. Do your own research, have your own conversations with various doctors. To your point earlier, if your physician doesn't support it, you're screwed. That's actually not the case. There are many, 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 many physicians, real doctors. And some people think these are like, ooh, voodoo medicine. No, these are actual real MDs. Generally, however, you're going to pay for it out of your pocket, right? Your insurance isn't going to cover it. So yes, maybe financially you're screwed. You got to pay for it yourself. If you are one of the lucky ones that has a doctor and you're in a plan and they're like, yes, we understand that hormones prevent a whole bunch of stuff. We'd rather help you prevent than have to pay for your problems later. Yes. If you're not, then you get to do like me and just decide that this is an investment in my health and my happiness. And if you have the ability to do it, you'll do it. But I do find it interesting, again, kind of talking about the physician angle, how, you know, prescribing antidepressants and anti-anxiety and all of the things that if my hormones were just optimal and balanced, I wouldn't have those issues.
Yeah.
So they have no problem prescribing a pharmaceutical, but they have real big concerns prescribing something that actually naturally occurred in our human bodies. We're just at an age where they're no longer being produced. So it's just interesting, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Before we wrap up, let's talk a little bit about your book with, you know, your guide for the men. What are some of the hot takes, no pun intended there, that you have for any guy who is living and sharing time and space with a female who either is or will go through menopause at some point?
So I think some of the key takeaways, there's a lot of emotional takeaway in there. And one of it being men tend to want to fix things, and this isn't really something that they fix. And so a lot of what you see is helping men understand what we're going through so that they, one, don't think that this is them. Because in my own relationship, you know, I really have had to have some very hard conversations with my husband that we don't expect to have. But as we go through a perimenopause or menopausal phase, lots of things happen to our bodies that aren't pleasant. And the book helps talk through, you know, what's happening to a woman. Because I know for me, I wasn't really interested in explaining to my husband why I have black wiry chin hairs now. But I think it was an odd conversation. But at some point I got to a point where I said, you know, when I don't see as well, now I have to have my reading glasses all the time. But sometimes I can't tell when I have a hair on my chin, and it's like a wire. It's like a whisker, and it's embarrassing. And so we sat down one day and I told him, I said, all right, I never thought I would have to say this, but if you see a whisker coming out of my chin, you really need to tell me so that I can address it, because I don't want to go in public, you know, and have something like this. And so the book kind of walks through what's some of the things like that are happening for women, and, you know, how a man can deal with it. Because 10, 15 years ago, if a man had said to me, oh, you've got some whiskers growing out of there, I probably would have, you know, blown off my lid and had a fit. But now I'm like, now I appreciate it because I need the extra assistance. So there's lots of little things in there about what happens to the woman and how he can help her cope with it. Even if it's something as simple as letting her know privately, that she's got a couple little chin hairs growing out. It talks about some of the physical aspects postmenopausal or during menopause with vaginal dryness and trouble with sex and intercourse and things like that. All things that a lot of couples experience, but nobody wants to talk about. So it's just kind of in your face in the book and very bold, because I think that's kind of how men see things. You know, you can't be wishy-washy. You can't expect them to read between the lines. And so the book really just throws it right in their face. You know, this is the Sahara Desert, and this is what you have to do to fix that. And it doesn't have anything to do with you. It doesn't have anything to do with her not being aroused or her not being interested. You know, it's just biology. So these are the things that happen, and these are the ways that you can help fix it. It does talk a lot about the emotional changes that women go through in the coping mechanisms that men can assist with. And, you know, sometimes that's a matter of do nothing. You know, if she needs space, give her space, you know, let her drive off in the car and go for a 4-hour drive. That's what she needs. And when she's ready, she'll come back and probably be able to have a conversation about what's happening. Men, I think, really they want answers right now. They want it fixed right now. And at least for me, that's just not who I am. So having the ability for my husband to just give me time and give me space to back off and not expect instant resolution helped. And I think a lot of men would benefit from just being patient. And I think ultimately realizing that sometimes they're the cause. I mean, don't get me wrong. Sometimes men are 100% the cause of what we go through. But in the course of hormone changes in menopause, it really is a problem with the woman. And it's something that she has to cope with and deal with. And I think men just need to understand that it really isn't them. Sometimes we're not honestly angry at them. We're angry at our bodies. We're angry at our minds. We're angry at ourselves. And so for men to just learn that, although they do plenty of things wrong, that, you know, in the course of menopause, just because she's yelling at you about your socks on the floor or your underwear that didn't make it into the hamper doesn't necessarily mean that that's really what she's angry about. And hopefully if they can be aware of all the changes that she's going through, that they'll be able to better equip themselves with handling, you know, whatever outbreaks she has or being upset or the physical changes, you know, different things like that. I think knowledge is power. And right now, men and women alike, but predominantly, you know, men really just don't have any clue. And it's something they don't want to talk about. They don't want to hear the word menopause. But I'm sorry, you got to hear it. You got to listen. You got to educate yourself. Otherwise, you know, your midlife crisis, you know, is going to be a lot harder than it has to be.
In other words, listeners, men just need to be better beings. I don't know. We all do, right? That's why we're having this conversation. So, Peach, thank you so much, one, for coming on the show, two, for writing these books. I really think these are going to be game changers for people. So we'll have all the information in the show notes of how people can reach you, find your books. I know a few people in my life that I think are going to definitely benefit from some of this guidance. So anything before we officially sign off that we haven't covered that you want the listeners to know?
No, I just really want to thank you for the opportunity to have this conversation. I think the more conversations we have, the more open and public we are about menopause, the better it is for every man and woman out there.
I agree. Thank you again for coming on. And listeners, now you know it is your time to go and be a better being.
Thank you for listening to the Be a Better Being podcast. We hope that what you heard today inspires you to embrace this journey of life with an open mind, a kind heart, and a willingness to learn and evolve. If you have a show topic idea or would like to be a guest, please visit betterbeings.net and fill out a contact form. Until next time, go and be a better being.